Anime begins with a dark, stormy night. A castle has been breached and invaders in black jackets are slaughtering knights in white. The leader of the invasion walks purposefully in no hurry and cuts down anyone who gets near him. Even the four elite knights guarding the young prince's chambers are no match for him. The last knight is very slim and feminine in appearance. This knight is the only one able to spill the enemy's blood, but not before being impaled and killed. As the knight declares she's lived another full life, she proceeds to undergo the process of magical reincarnation, returning as Lady Rishi Imgard Weitzner. She stands before her fiancé Crown Prince Dietrich as he is leveling charges of being a devious woman against her and annulling their engagement. Not only does Rishi take all of this in stride, she responds as if she knew it was coming, because it's the seventh time she's relived it. The first time it came as a shock and she was disowned, exiled and thrown onto the streets with only the clothes on her back. But she happened to meet some friendly merchants and ended up becoming one herself, when she was swept up in a war, killed and reincarnated. She left with more money and effects, and while she didn't encounter the merchants, she used the amassed knowledge from that life to become an accomplished herbalist. When she was killed again in the war, she became a scientist in her next life, and a simple handmaiden in the life after that. In her sixth life, she cut her hair short, disguised herself as a man and became a knight, only to be cut down by Arnold Hein, Emperor of Gokhein. While this is the only loop in which he kills her personally, Arnold is the one who starts the war in every loop, which always claims her life 5 years after her engagement is broken. After excusing herself from Prince Dietrich's false charges a seventh time, Rishi decides not to use the main entrance to depart this time. That turns out to be quite fortuitous, as who should she nearly collide with as she rounds a corner but Arnold Hein himself. The shock of suddenly standing before the man who took her sixth life causes her to blurt out his name, including the title of emperor, which at this point in the timeline he has not yet achieved. He is merely a crown prince. Rishi begs his forgiveness as she's in a hurry. She removes her shoes and leaps out the window, landing into a roll to protect herself, then breaks the heels off her shoes and runs off. Arnold is thoroughly amused by this spectacle. Delayed by her surprise encounter, Rishi ends up encountering Prince Dietrich outside her house with her parents, guards, and commoner bystanders all present. Dietrich, who is a right piece of work, notes that from the state of her she must be feeling heartbroken and overwhelmed with grief. But armed with six loops and a combined 30 years worth of experience, Rishi levels with the prince. She will be okay without him, she says, because she knows that she can go out into the world and find her own worth, purpose and happiness. When Lady Marie, the woman who framed her, speaks up for the prince, Rishi tells her she holds no ill will towards her, as she knows she only usurped her in order to save her family. She urges Marie to lead a life where both she and her family can keep smiling. Rishi continues on her way, but Dietrich orders his knights to stop her. As one approaches her from behind, she steals his sword and uses it to block a strike from Crown Prince Arnold. The fact that she successfully parries his strike pleases him, as does the fact she knew he was holding back. But then Arnold suddenly gets on one knee and asks for her hand in marriage. She declines Prince Arnold's proposal at first because it's coming from someone who instigated a war that led to her death in all past loops, and someone who personally slew her in the last one. It gives her a blind spot to the fact that this Arnold is not the bloodthirsty emperor of those past, not yet at least. As a crown prince, Arnold is used to getting what he wants. When he tells her he's fallen in love, it's an acknowledgement he's never encountered someone like Rishi before. As such, he agrees to all of Rishi's very specific conditions for giving him her hand in marriage. Those conditions include hiring the Arya Trading Company for everything needed in the ceremony, a place to receive foreign guests, a separate residence from the emperor, and most importantly, leave to laze about and loaf about the castle. Her final condition is that he not lay a finger on her, but when she's asleep in the carriage leaning against his sword like a grizzled knight, she senses he's about to touch her, wakes up and unsheathes the sword. Noble ladies aren't supposed to fall asleep on swords or sense movements while asleep and not being touched, and yet she can. When some bandits attack the prince's convoy, he locks her in the carriage for her own safety and joins the fray personally. When she picks the lock, a skill learned from her past life as a maid, she sees he swiftly dispatched all of the bandits himself, but notably didn't kill any of them, another sign this younger Arnold is not yet too far gone. When some of the guards report numbness near their wounds, Arnold and Rishi both conclude it's the work of poison. She even knows its composition and tells the prince she can make an antidote with the plants she has on hand. When the soldiers hesitate to accept the bomb, she cuts her own arm with the poison blade and treats it, which convinces them it's safe. Rishi later learns that the men are not just random guards but Arnold's hand-picked retainers, so chosen for their diversity of backgrounds and experiences. When she finds his gaze lingering on her, she asks what's up, and he simply says he finds her unfathomable and can't wait to see what means she'll use to entertain him. Rishi tells him it's not her intent, which Arnold understands. He then gets on one knee and bows to her and thanks for saving his retainers, explaining that they were wary because they knew her engagement was broken and still wondered what their prince was getting into. When Arnold notes that he told his father, the emperor, that he stole her, Rishi states that that makes her a hostage of the empire, which gives her that much more freedom to laze about like she wants. Rishi is overjoyed to arrive in Gokhan's imperial capital, where he gets a royal welcome and the streets are packed with smiling faces. When Arnold reports that the villa where she'll dwell is in no fair state, she is unbothered, donning simple work clothes and tying her hair back. Rishi once again calls upon her maid experience to clean the whole house herself. While fetching washing water from the well, Rishi encounters three maids bullying a fourth that they call a novice. While they all have 3 years of experience, Rishi, with 5 years under her belt, helps the novice up and ignores the others. While admiring the city from the balcony as the sun begins to set, Rishi's night senses are set off by Arnold lurking inside. He is impressed as he purposefully masked his presence only for her to detect him anyway. Rishi tells Arnold that while others may deem the things she's learned unnecessary to her station, she treasures them as riches she'll always have. To her surprise, Arnold is in full agreement and declares that she should be free to do whatever she wants without constraints. When she asks why, he says simply that he's fallen completely in love with her, and that he doesn't find her various skills pointless but delightful from the bottom of his heart. As he leaves, he asks her to think of something she wants, as he just touched her that breaks her last condition of not laying a finger on her. Arnold's personal aide Oliver delivering Rishi a list of the honored guests invited to the wedding ceremony. He also hands out a list of the attendees for a party to be held in the kingdom. Later that day, Rishi goes to Arnold's chamber to formally request that he allows her to select her maids. She also tells her fiancé that she doesn't find any dishonor in being labeled as a hostage, therefore she assures Arnold that he can formally reveal her as his fiancé at the night's party. Crown Prince arriving at the lavish party with Rishi Weitzer, and introducing her as his fiancé to everyone present at the party. Undoubtedly, this revelation shocks the attendees, especially the ones who brought their daughters as prospective brides to the Crown Prince. When she asks why Arnold announced so quickly, he says it's better to make it apparent now that he will protect her no matter what happens. She comes out and says she thinks he might be the most dangerous person to her, for one because she can't match his swordplay. After he invites her to spar with him and agrees to give her training in the near future, the two engage in a dance in the center of the ballroom. Each time Rishi tries to surprise him by taking the lead, he counters with a twirl, resulting in a dashing display of footwork and shifting tensions. In effect, the dance is their first sparring session and there was no need for swords. As expected, the women who had come specifically to present themselves as the Crown Prince's potential wife don't use swords either, to express the frustration with his choice. One such woman offers Rishi a very obviously glass of wine as a gesture of goodwill. Sure enough, it contains red pepper. Rishi knows because of her herbalist past. Knowing what's in it, she has a sip and shows no discomfort. When she steps out to the balcony, Prince Arnold joins her and finishes off the wine she didn't want to waste. Arnold wants to confirm if Rishi was thinking of someone other than him while they were dancing. She can't say it was his future self in another life, so she pivots to her medical experience, saying she was worried for his health, asking if he had ever been wounded where the neck and shoulder meet. Sure enough, he unbuttons his collar to reveal a nasty scar made from multiple vicious strikes with the intent to kill. She noticed he had trouble moving that shoulder while dancing. He is clearly impressed she noticed it, as he's never revealed it to anyone, but he's not ready to tell even her how he got it. With the party over, the maids anticipate who among them will be chosen for the Crown Prince's fiancé's household staff, completely unaware that Lady Rishi is right among them doing her own laundry. A senior maid, Diana, scolds Elsie and her fellow newbie, saying they don't have a chance at being chosen. Rishi asks them about Diana and learns she came from a wealthy merchant family that drowned in debt and necessitated her going to work as a maid. Rishi makes things extra dramatic as Oliver announces her and she slowly descends her staircase. When their lady turns out to be Rishi, Diana is shocked. She's even more shocked when all the newest maids are selected to be her maids, while she and her more experienced colleagues aren't. Diana gets teary-eyed as she admits her family had nothing and there was no one to protect her, but she worked her ass off to become a maid, only to fail to teach the newer ones properly. Watching her genuine remorse, Elsie and the other newbie come to her side to comfort her. It's revealed Rishi isn't firing Diana, she's promoting her. She chose newbies because wants her villa to be a training ground for new maids. Teaching them to read and write will not only make them better maids but make them more quick to adapt to changes in their lives. She asks Diana to create teaching materials for the other maids and Diana agrees. With her household staff in place, Rishi dons her gaudiest and most expensive dress for her first meeting with the Arya Trading Company. She explains to Elsie that the dress is her battle garb for her talks, and in her head she knows that wearing something so loud will give them the impression of a mark. Despite knowing Arya's Cane Tully in a past life, he sees right through her entreaties for procuring her wedding, turning her down flat with the excuse that his wares are not becoming of an imperial crown princess. While initially bewildered by such a stonewalling, Rishi remembers the opening Cane gave her before departing. Cane said he and his men will remain in town for a bit, so Rishi dyes her hair and sneaks out of her villa. Rishi drinks all of Cane's men under the table before he even arrives, leaving the two alone for negotiations. Rishi obviously can't tell him her overarching plan to prevent her death. But she can tell him she wants to be a trading partner and ally, not merely a customer. Cane agrees to give her a week to come up with a business plan that's worth his while. She sneaks back into her chambers to find Prince Arnold waiting for her. He's not mad. He made clear she can do what she wants with her time, but isn't enthused about her going out alone in the dead of night unescorted. If she has future business in town, he'll accompany her without interfering in that business. She prepares him a midnight snack of soup with medicinal herbs, lamenting that she's a terrible cook, but he enjoys it and they eat it all together. Before bidding her goodnight, Arnold asks Rishi if she's met his younger brother. She hasn't, and he warns her not to entertain him if he shows up. Next morning we see his brother waking up in Rishi's garden plot, introducing himself as Theodore. He has the face and voice of an angel but gets close to Rishi and tells her he intends to save her from her hostage status. Rishi would like to dig further into what exactly Prince Theo's whole deal is, but she only has a week to come up with her business idea for the chief. So she tables that for now, after her bodyguards are unable to even tell her how the brothers get along. She does accidentally walk in on Arnold ordering the armies be brought into the city to protect the commoners. She notes that this Prince Arnold, who seems to be forcibly enacting policy to benefit the commoners, isn't the same prince who killed her. Upon retiring to her chambers, Rishi finds a sealed note ostensibly from Arnold summoning her to the chapel at midnight to tell her a secret. But Rishi wasn't born yesterday, and when she arrives dressed down in mourning black, she fully expects Theodore, not Arnold, to be there. Theodore invited Rishi to the chapel to tell her that her brother is a murderous monster who even killed his own mother, and his killings aren't limited to wartime. Rishi responds that she's fully aware of the facts and has still chosen to be Prince Arnold's bride. Before Theo can protest, Arnold arrives, no doubt tipped off to the meeting by Rishi. Arnold shoos Theodore away, then tells Rishi he warned her to stay away from him. When Rishi asks why everyone says he's so cruel when she's only seen him as a kind and considerate man, Arnold hisses that he's looked after her too well. Putting his hand around her throat, he orders her to disabuse herself of that false notion. But she won't, she trusts what she's seen and can't see him as a cruel person. Rishi decides to frame her situation as having dreams that she's been killed, and the lingering fear she's already dead and just living in a long dream after her death. She tells him that whether this life is a dream or not, she's not running away. If there's resolve in her eyes, it's the resolve to live as his wife. Stunned by her words, Arnold pulls her close and kisses her, saying there's no need for that kind of resolve. The meaning of those words eludes Rishi, who is working herself down to the bone developing the product she'll use to win over Chief Tully and Arya Trading Company. That product is nail polish that protects and strengthens nails. Her maid Elsie is enchanted by the look of Rishi's sparkly smooth nails, and Rishi applies some on her hand as well. While doing so, Rishi learns that Elsie can't afford to live her life for herself. It's all she can do to put food on the table for her poor family. Poverty seems to be a deep-seated problem in the Empire. In the meantime, she offers Elsie a bottle of the polish in whatever color she likes. Rishi's kindness brings tears to her eyes. Rishi knows going into her meeting with Tully that simply presenting the product of nail polish won't be enough to persuade him. She's not a fellow merchant but a customer, and Tully says the finest merchants choose their own customers. Rishi proposes building upon the prince's establishment of a minimum wage and hiring labor from the slums. Tully dismisses this as needless charity, but Rishi uses his own words from one of her previous loops to ask him why simply choose customers when they can produce them. Giving the poor jobs will give them money to spend, thus making their employees their customers as well. Inspired by Elsie's story, Rishi is determined to turn the slums from a place of despair to a place of hope and opportunity. When Tully sees how badly Rishi wants to work with him, he tells her he could use that fixation to wring her dry, but that's when she whips out her trump card. She knows that Kane's little sister Arya has an illness. In previous loops since then, she'd become a skilled herbalist and scholar, and discovered a medicine that can cure Arya within a year. When Tully bends to one knee and basically surrenders, Rishi tells him she'll give him the ingredients and formula for the medicine without conditions. Rishi would only ask that Tully consider that the families in the slums care about their families as he cares about his. Tully again bows and tells Rishi that her words have moved him to think about the people of the slums for the first time, and he agrees to do business together. Rishi had barely slept for days and she collapses out of apparent exhaustion. As such, she asks the knights to inform Elsie. However, when they come back, they discover that Rishi is gone. It's revealed that Theodore has Rishi abducted with Elsie and Camel's help. Theodore reveals that he has imprisoned Rishi to annoy his brother. However, Rishi speculates that the actual reason behind his act is to get his brother's recognition. This infuriates Theodore and he leaves. At that moment, it's revealed that Rishi knew about her abduction right from the start. Since it was a direct order from Theodore, Elsie and Camel were bound to follow it. However, Rishi assured them that nothing would happen. Following this, Theodore confronts Arnold and reveals about Rishi's abduction. He threatens to harm her if Arnold doesn't allow him to become the next in line to the throne. However, the Crown Prince remains unfazed because he knows Rishi's potential. At that moment, Theodore surprisingly discovers Rishi coming out of the front doors. She lectures him about the right way to capture a captive, which frightens him. Theo may have though he had this grand plan, but seeing it all turn to dust so quickly should be a hint to quit putting on the unhinged evil younger prince act. Theo doesn't hate his brother, nor does he want him to suffer. Rather, this whole overblown act was to create such a commotion and disgrace himself, giving him cover to abdicate his place in the line of succession. She's done a little research and can tell while his public acts of charity in the slums have ceased, he continues to funnel his own money there. Theo insists that his brother hates him, despises him, casting him out, even killing him is preferable to not being accepted. After Theo runs off, Rishi tells him his brother does care about him, otherwise he wouldn't have ordered her to stay away from him. She also finally understands what he meant by her not needing resolve to be his wife. He intends to abdicate and disappear. Arnold finds it adorable that Rishi can't read his intentions, and that he's better off not understanding. She asks him to consider a possible future in his brother disappears and to live a life where he has no regrets. As for her, she fully intends to live her life as his wife with no regrets. After that, she climbs to the top of the tower where she finds Theo. Theo was thinking about the one time Arnold praised him, after he used his own body to protect his vassals in a field hospital. Arnold is proud of him but warned him never to put his life at risk like that again. Rishi confirms her suspicions to the one who has watched Arnold more closely than anyone. He's trying to leave the throne to Theo. Ever since that time he was praised, Theo watched his brother for the express purpose of determining the best way to be useful to him. He believes Arnold disappearing rather than ruling is a mistake. Even if it means disappearing before Arnold can, he'll do it. Rishi tries to stop him, but Theo's mind is already set and he falls backwards over the tower. Rishi lunges out to catch him, but her muscles finally gives out. It appears that Theo will fall to his death, but his brother catches him. Once Theo is safe, Arnold slaps him, then tells him not to put his life at risk again. When Rishi sees that all is now well with the brothers, she finally lets herself pass out. Theo is concerned, but Arnold simply smiles as she rests in his lap. When Rishi wakes up the next morning, Arnold is writing at her desk, having stayed with her the whole time. He delivers a letter from Theo apologizing for how he treated her and telling her he's in her debt. He's also agreed to join forces with her in ensuring Arnold doesn't disappear somewhere. Arnold asking her to think of something else he can do for her since he couldn't resist kissing her in the chapel. This makes a flustered Rishi retreat within her sheets, and Arnold thanks her for looking after his little brother. Rishi smiles and tells him not to worry about it since he'll be her little brother too. Rishi Irmgard whitens her, thanking Theodore for not blaming Camel and Elsie for their deeds. She also applauds him for restarting his business in the slums and asks for a favor regarding Arnold. After that, she goes to Arnold's castle to inform the Crown Prince that she has prepared a room for him in the villa. She also reveals that the maids have worked extremely hard to organize everything. While he thought she wanted to live alone, her intention all along was for the two of them to live together. Not only is he pleased with the room, but also the fact Rishi is so good at bringing out the best in people. Rishi also asks if she can take up Arnold's offer to spar with her, and the next thing we see, they're standing in a yard together with wooden swords, and one hand tied behind their backs. Arnold also has an eye patch and waits on one leg in order to simulate battlefield conditions, when a knight must keep fighting even when one or more limbs or eyes are gone. While Arnold is clearly holding back, his skills are still plain to behold, as are his real-time instructions to Rishi as she comes at him. Since she already has quite a bit of combat training, this serves as an advanced lesson. He also comes at her with the same combo that killed her in her past life. And the way she dodges it makes him think she knows of someone more powerful than him. She can't say that he's right, because the him of 5 years from now will be stronger than he is now. Ultimately, she impresses him by making him take a step to dodge her last strike before he disarms her. When she can't get up due to her arms and legs shaking, he gathers her into a princess carry, as he wasn't about to just leave her out there in the yard. Since she agreed to do one thing, he asks if she lost. He asks her to keep her schedule clear in 2 days so they can go into town. She also learns his birthday on December 28th. Later, Rishi finds out from Oliver that Arnold didn't sleep the previous night due to work. As such, she takes it upon herself to help the Crown Prince fall asleep. She prepares the bed, lights a candle, and also covers the windows with curtains for Arnold to sleep. She almost treats him like a child, which intrigues the Crown Prince. She sets him up in his darkened room and employs the little tricks she used when she was a maid to help him sleep. While she's not particularly embarrassed to lay beside him in his bed, she does get flustered when he looks at her with those deep blue piercing eyes. She's seemingly successful in getting him to rest a little, but she's the one who ends up nodding off, which speaks to her trust in him. Rishi returns to her castle, where Elsie hands her a parcel from the Arya Trading Company. Rishi opens it and finds a blonde wig in order to pose as a candidate in the Imperial Knights. It will be an intensive 10-day training period. Rishi training at the King's Candidate disguised as a man. It's revealed that she had Theodore Auguste Hines help to make it work. As such, Rishi uses the alias of Lucius to train with other candidates. During the training session, she meets Count Lavine, the Guardian of the North and the faithful retainer of the Imperial House of Gokheim. In her internal monologue, Rishi reveals from her previous life experience that Lavine was killed as a great sinner by Arnold. The silver-haired gentleman informs them that he will become their instructor starting the next day. Later at the castle, Arnold invites Rishi on an incognito visit to the town, but doesn't mention the purpose. He's surprised when the Duke's daughter appears on the date day all decked up, thanks to her maid Elsie's efforts. The visit to the town becomes a lovely affair for Rishi, who doesn't miss the opportunity to let Arnold try a delicacy. At that moment, the Crown Prince takes his fiancée to a jewelry store. The woman in charge of the store shows Rishi a set of gems and asks which one of them is fake. Rishi takes some time and asks for appraisal tools. After carefully observing the gems, she surmises that they are all fake, and the woman apologizes for doubting her. It revealed that Arnold wants to gift Rishi a ring for their wedding. As such, he asks her to choose a stone. Overwhelmed by the gesture, Rishi inquires the shopkeeper woman whether she has a gem similar to Arnold's ocean blue eyes. However, the ring isn't the only reason why Arnold invited Rishi. Apparently, the Crown Prince received a letter from the Koyal's family, who wanted to congratulate him on his wedding before the ceremony because they wouldn't be able to attend the main event. Rishi and Arnold welcome Kyle Morgan, the Prince of the Koyal Kingdom, to the castle, who congratulates them on their wedding on behalf of his father, the King of Koyals. He even kneels before Rishi and compliments her for her beauty. After he leaves, Arnold informs Rishi that Kyle is bringing in some Koyal scholars. Therefore, preparation of a banquet is needed. He also says that he will bring Kyle and Lavine face to face, Rishi getting worried because she suspects Lavine may find out that she's Lucius. Rishi wondering how she can keep her identity as Lucille from being discovered by Lord Lavine. She's also seen in the garden, preparing medicine for Kyle. At that moment she meets a gentleman from the Coyals named Michel Heaven, who happens to be her teacher from her third life. It revealed that Rishi's expertise in herbs and medicines is all thanks to Michelle's teachings. The would-be crown princess' knowledge of medicines and herbs pleases Michel so much that he wants to make her his pupil. Undoubtedly Rishi is delighted at the prospect, and she calls him sensei. During their conversation Michel also finds out that Rishi is making a medicine for Coyal's prince Kyle. After that Michel, Rishi and Kyle together at the castle. The Coyal scholar informs Kyle how the crown princess has become his pupil. He even tells him to try her medicine, which he gulps down despite its terrible taste. Unfortunately, after drinking the potion several times, Kyle begins to feel under the weather, so he leaves. Meanwhile, Rishi thinks about her past with Michelle. At that moment, the crown prince Arnold arrives. He greets the Coyal scholar and tells him that if he needs anything, he will provide it. While leaving with Rishi, Arnold asks her if she stays up late at night all the time. He gifts her his precious pocket watch, which moves the crown princess. During their conversation, it's revealed that Michel Heaven is not an ordinary scholar but an alchemist. Later, Rishi receives a letter from Madame Michaela, who informs her that she will shorten the delivery time for the ring, as she can commission a craftsman from Coyals in Gokhine. Along with the letter, she also sent a preview image of the ring to the banquet event, where Kyle tells Rishi that her medicine has helped him a lot. The crown princess, though, remains vigilant about Lavine's presence at the banquet. She even pinpoints the location of Lavine amidst a vast crowd gathered at the party. At the same time, Rishi meets the son of Michaela, who discloses how talented the craftsmen from the Coyals are. Later, Kyle meets Arnold Hine outside the party. He requests Arnold to sign a treaty with the Coyals because the neighboring countries are threatening to wipe them out. However, the Gokhine's crown prince rejects the offer because he finds no merit in it. Interestingly, Rishi was eavesdropping on them. From her past lives experiences, she knows that Coyals will get destroyed in the future if Arnold doesn't sign the treaty, but she hopes that things will be different in this life. A distressed Kyle Morgan cleverly informing Michel Heaven about the conversation he had with Arnold Hine the previous night. He reveals how the Gokhine's prince refused to sign the treaty because it's more in his nature to invade and control another country instead of joining forces with them. Arnold's response intrigues Michel, who thinks he will be the ideal person to use his poison. Meanwhile, Rishi, disguised as Lucille, looks distressed about the whole affair between Kyle and Arnold. She's worried about a potential war that can break out. The knight's instructor Lavine understands his plight and informs that he lost his son in a battle. While he is proud of him, he would have loved to see his son live. Nevertheless, he reminds Lucille about a soldier's duty. After a while, Arnold arrives at the location to supervise the knight's training. He immediately sees through Rishi's disguise. However, the crown prince doesn't prevent her from taking the knight's course. Instead, he tells Rishi to be careful about hiding her identity. At the same time, the duo converses about the offer Arnold rejected. The crown prince reveals that he has no intention of signing forces with a country with no future. Undoubtedly, this worries Rishi even more. She recalls how she met Kyle for the first time in her third life. Later, Rishi giving Kyle a new set of medicines. She also tells him that she listened to his conversation with Arnold the previous night. Rishi wants a peaceful treaty between the two countries, so she implores Kyle to sign a personal alliance with her. Besides Kyle, Rishi also visits Michelle. She excitedly explains her love for learning to the alchemist. At that moment, Michel reveals his plan. He wants to have Arnold Hine use his black powder, because he deems him fit to use it. Rishi knows from her past lives experience that Michelle's black powder can bring destruction and kill countless lives. However, the alchemist feels that every being in this world exists to serve its purpose, including him. Since the black powder was created to bring destruction, it cannot be used for anything other than that, and the same applies to him. A flashback reveals Michelle's tough childhood, including how he was branded an evil person. In a conversation between Rishi and Michelle, Rishi feels she cannot stop the Professor Michelle if everything goes according to his plan. Rishi thinking about how she can stop Michelle's experiment, a fatigued and frustrated Rishi takes a break out on the balcony, and is treated to a wondrous sight, a cloud of glowing fireflies. Arnold is also drawn outside to his neighboring balcony, and Rishi jumps across to be with him. He instinctively reaches out to catch her even though she could easily leap the distance. He also came outside with sword in hand, thinking at first they were the torches of a battlefield in the streets below. When Rishi compliments his deep blue eyes, he tells her he once wanted to gouge them out since they were the same as his father's. Arnold believes it's the nature of his blood that he should look upon the peaceful sleeping capital with revulsion, but Rishi tells him it's not nature, but one's amassed experiences that color their perspective, and that means he can learn her perspective that sees the beauty in his capital and his country. When he tells her he'll discard her if it becomes necessary, she sprinkles a little truth in her response, saying she'll become a maid, a knight, or an herbalist, anything to slip back into the palace and return to his side. However much he may hate his eyes, she'll always believe they're the most beautiful. After days of planning, Prince Kyle finally gets his audience with Prince Arnold, who is short on patience. Rishi is wearing all new jewelry, showing off the technological skill and an artistic talent Koyals has to offer. Then she presents him with the watch he gave her, only for him to notice it's a very good reproduction, also created by Koyals artisans. The technology used to so perfectly copy his watch could one day expand to machines that could create a new world, carriages without horses and ships without sails. To all of this optimistic pablum, Arnold basically says all of the things Kyle wants to provide can simply be taken by military force. That's when Kyle says he attempted this second negotiation because Rishi told him it was impossible that Prince Arnold wouldn't want to attain the power to make the future a more wonderful place. Like Rishi, Kyle can also see the kindness hiding behind the scowls and threats. They don't trust his looks but his actions to make Gokhine a better place. Their conversation is interrupted by Prince Theodore, who urges Rishi to come with him. Throughout this meeting, his men have been tailing Professor Michel to keep him away from Arnold, but he's given them the slip, in some cases by using what amounts to sleeping potions. When they finally do track him down, he's in the courtyard of the palace, ready to make an impromptu demonstration of his black powder to Prince Arnold. As no one expected that Rishi would show Michel, Kyle, Arnold and the entire capital the good way to use black powder, which is with pretty fireworks, this application never occurred to Michel, so caught up in being the bad guy he had one hell of a blind spot. But that's what his trusty student is for. Count Lavine is about to have Michel arrested for threatening to unleash a more violent demonstration of the powder on the city, but it's Prince Arnold himself who tell him to stand down. He's agreed to a technological alliance with Koyals after all. He's not doing this out of kindness but because it's the pragmatic thing to do. Rishi also privately hopes that in seeing a weapon of war used in such a pretty and joyful way, perhaps Arnold can draw some parallels to his own war-hardened self. Michel bids farewell to Rishi where they met in this loop, at her herb garden, and he admits that he was wrong. She's going to make a great empress and bride of Arnold. It isn't just her scientific mind but her political one that she flexed in getting him to rethink his plans and getting Arnold to sign a deal with Koyals. Michel is going to be very busy fulfilling the kingdom's obligations to Gokhine, that leaves the deliverer of the ring. Rishi presents the box to Arnold, who tells her that wearing the ring is unnecessary as he only requested that he be allowed to gift the ring to her, but it's not unnecessary to Rishi. In her country, a wife-to-be wears the ring on their ring finger and keeps it there for life. Rishi doesn't take no for an answer, and Arnold gets on one knee to properly slip the ring on her finger, a sequence during which time she briefly forgets how to breathe. Now that the ring, with a sapphire the color of Arnold's eyes, is on her finger, she feels like she can accomplish anything. Arnold finds himself in a much better mood than he'd imagined. Rishi asks for another boon, which Arnold is happy to grant, that they journey across the world together so she can show him all of the beautiful and wonderful things in the world. He agrees, and adds that he's already found one of those things, referring to her of course. And that's the end of anime. Please do like and subscribe if you enjoyed it.